Good evening and welcome to the Salem News High School Hockey Podcast. Phil Stacey, Matt Williams back at it again from the cozy confines of our world headquarters here in Beverly. Willie, we are now firmly ensconced into the second half of the season here.
Ensconced we are.
You like that, huh?
Yep, I love it.
That's good, huh? What's on your mind here this week or coming up? Or what do you see here? Any new changes, developments?
Well, hockey-wise, you know, there are always things going on. I think, you know, telling game last week, Marblehead took Peabody to the woodshed. And, you know, two teams that are going to need some points down the stretch. Marblehead maybe turning a corner, leaving that first half behind. And Peabody, you know, halfway into the season here, still kind of looking to get its legs under it. And, you know, if they don't get their legs under them pretty fast here, they're going to find that the season is slipping away. You know, they're hoping to get Matt McIsaac back from an injury maybe later on this week or the following week, which will help them. But certainly if you're in Division III, North at least, you got to be looking at that and saying, oh boy, you know, here comes Marblehead down the stretch. I got a feeling by the end of the season, that's going to be a team that not a lot of teams are looking forward to playing. You know, it's going to be one of those teams that's sort of laying in the weeds and you know, yeah, maybe not as strong as they've been, but I don't want to see them on my side of the bracket type of thing.
Well, we can break it down, I think, by this point into three pretty distinct categories. You're in or you're going to get in, you're not going to get in, and you're going to be looking at points between now and the end of the season. Virtually every game, you need to have 2 points for a win, 1 point for a tie. You can't afford to be giving away points.
Yeah.
I think into that category, we definitely have Peabody.
Yep.
There's no question the Tanners need every point they can get to that 20. They're going to need to get into the tournament. I think Marblehead's in the same boat. Of course, they can finish second, first or second in their league and get in that way. I think even Swampscott, we're talking about. I mean, yes, they've struggled a little bit playing up against the NEC North teams, but lost to Rockport. That's a team they should beat. I mean, Rockport's talented. Don't get me wrong, at 10-3, but that's a game Swampscott should win. They have the scoring, they have defensive depth, they have goaltending. They shouldn't be losing that game. So now they find themselves in a position where they're going to have to be counting points. We're going to get back into those leagues, especially in the conference here. The North team's going to be playing each other, the Beverly's, Damases, Gloucester's, Saugus, Winthrop, and Peabody, and of course the South teams with Marblehead, Swampscott, Lynn, Revere, and Salem all be playing each other. So those are three teams right there that I think are going to be looking at points. I wouldn't necessarily put Beverly in that category, although they're just a game over 500. Real good win against Triton. Second 2-0 shutout of the year for them over a 10-3 or 9-3 Triton team, I want to say.
Yeah.
We said it before, this is nothing new. When Beverly plays its game, they can skate with anybody. They hammered Danvers, and Danvers is 10-2. You know, they beat Danvers early in the season, granted,
but
6-2. So if Beverly can maintain that level of play, I think they're a lock for the postseason. If they start with the up and down again, they're going to find themselves in that same boat as Peabody, Marblehead, and Swampscott.
Yeah, definitely need some points in Beverly, and you know, certainly I think we can pencil in St. John's Prep for the tournament, certainly, if not, you know, for the Super 8, certainly, if they
I'd be stunned, honestly. If the way they're playing, can you really tell me they're not one of the 10 best teams in the state? And, well, of course, we don't see everybody. We have to go by what we see, you know, in other publications or through Twitter or whatnot. But, I mean, we know enough about who they are and who they play. We've seen them several times each. I mean, they have to be one of the, barring a catastrophic collapse.
Yeah, I mean, my opinion on it would be if they do not win enough games in the league down the stretch to get themselves into the top six, and even if they were to have one of those Super 8 play-in games and lose, they would almost automatically become the favorite in a potential Division 1 North bracket. I think they're very good. They're one of the top 15 teams in the state in all divisions. And, you know, how that works out with Super 8, who knows? But I certainly think they're in the conversation.
Well, to me, I mean,
tons
it boils
of talent,
down to this.
You know, et cetera.
You have two elite forwards in Brian Pinot and, of course, Sam Kirka. Mm-hmm. You have a dominant defenseman in Nick Pandolina. And you have, arguably, in a year without a great goaltender out there, you have a superb four-year starter who, when at the top of his game, David Letarte can win games for you.
And two, I mean, really, Jared Hines, if they need him, is a great,
played very
you
well
know,
as a backup.
Tremendous backup.
The second line has been coming along well. I like the way they're playing. That young Jack McCarthy really impresses me as a center. I think the third line is playing really well. I mean, certainly, like most third lines in high school, not a lot of points, not a lot of glory and all, but Nick Gianelli and that group that he's with have really, really played well. They're grinding. They're winning those battles in the neutral zone. They're hemming other teams in. I mean, they're really playing well. I think the prep is getting hot at the right time, as they've done the last few years. They hit a little slump early on. They pick it up in the midseason. And in the second half, generally when they get into the playing these conference teams for the second time and then some of their non-league games, tends to get, easier is the wrong word to use, but maybe a little bit less of a burden for them. They could get on a nice little run here. Four in a row, going as a variant on Saturday. I mean, I think the future is bright for this team moving forward.
What do they have, four losses?
Four losses.
And three of them are in the league or all four in the league?
No, three in the league. To Xaverian, BC High, and Malden Catholic.
What's the other one?
The other loss, boy, I should know this off the top of my head. It was non-league. They beat Hingham. They were upset by, was it Woburn? No, somebody.
It was Woburn. Dan Harrison was there. It was definitely Woburn. Well, I was going to say, point being with the prep is, you know, in the Catholic Conference, those things are going to even out. You know, they're probably going to go, you know, just about everybody in that league is going to go some combination between 5-3 and 3-5. You know, they're so close.
Yeah.
What's impressive to me about the prep, with the exception of that you know, hiccup against Woburn, is they go out against their non-conference teams and they're destroying people. Great win on the road at Hingham. I mean, AC, 6-0, 7-0, whatever it was. You know, that's a 500 AC team, a team that's going to be in the Division I North tournament, a team in a good league. I mean, you know, great coach.
A team that
you don't just beat AC 7-0. I mean, that's impressive.
And
to
a
me.
Team that battled St. Mary's, tough game, St. Mary's out of Lynn, which obviously is having a great
4
season.
4-0. Yeah, I mean,
4-0.
You know,
so
to me, that's an impressive win. And you know, you almost take those Catholic Conference games. You know, and I'm not a big SEC football guy. You know, guys that know me, I'm always bashing them. But the Catholic Conference is sort of that same mentality where everybody's going to be. You know, have a couple losses in that league. It's too good. It's too good. They know each other too well.
Well, and if
it's too much familiarity.
If I'm St. John's prep, I would rather win the second of those two games than the first, because that shows improvement over the first time. They play at Xaverian on Saturday down in Westwood. They have Malden Catholic in Malden next Tuesday. Chance for them to get a little bit of revenge and keep that push going. I mean, they're 4 points away from a tournament berth right now. You want to get that as early as possible and keep going. Let's switch gears for 1 second here. The one team that we covered, we haven't talked about, and we haven't had a chance to see them much this year, is Masconomet. Again, up and down, up and down. I dug up an interesting stat the other day. Masconomet has 9 games left. They're 5-6 at this point, so a game under qualifying. 8 of their last 9 games, Willie, on the road. Now, they haven't played great at home, obviously, 5-6.
Sure.
But 8 of the last 9 on the road. Is that one of those things? I mean, it's not a pro team where you physically go on the road and stay in a hotel and all, but can it be a bonding experience for these guys, and maybe playing away from their home barn actually helps the physical act of getting on a bus and preparing mentally for a game that you're going to, that kind of thing?
Maybe. I mean, I hope so. You know, they've been so up and down, it's hard to wonder, you know, where's their focus? And you know, anything you can use to get focused, you know, maybe they can manufacture some type of us against the world adversity situation. I mean, whatever it takes to get everybody in that trip, because Masconomet, I mean, they're a talented team, but they're not an overtly talented team. And so they need all 18 guys pulling in the same direction. They can't have, you know, this line looking this way and this line looking that way. I mean, they're like one of those crew boats, you know, that you see. Everybody's going to be rowing in the same direction.
Yeah.
And so whatever it takes for Coach Blackwell to get that happening, you know, more power to him. I mean,
well,
I don't think it's impossible.
Matt Cardillo.
They're good, yeah. I mean, there's no reason for them to
real
be
good
fine.
First line with Zingarelli, DiGiorgio, and Crowther. They just have not gotten the secondary scoring, and they've given up goals at really bad times. Third period goals against are killing this team.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, it's tough in that league. You know, everybody's so up and down, and maybe that's part of the focus issue, too. You come in the first time around, you don't know how good these teams are going to be. You know, is Pawtucket terrible this year, or are they pretty good? You know, Triton. You know, same thing. Oh, they're having an up year, but maybe the first time Vasco saw them, they didn't expect that.
And yet they go and beat North Andover. They lose to a
exactly.
team like Ensbury,
right.
And they beat North Andover. So
hopefully for them, same effect as St. John's Prep. You know, the second time around when they see these teams, they know what to expect. They're not going to be lulled asleep by an Amesbury, which maybe doesn't have a great reputation, but, you know, is having a pretty good year type of thing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I certainly would be remiss if they were missing from that Division II North field. But at the same time, the way they've played it, I can't say I'd be shocked either.
Before we head out of here tonight, just talk for a minute about two teams that have really struggled this year. Salem has 1 win in 12 games. They're 1-11. Probably, I don't want to say not surprising, but given Salem's woes, you know, players learning the game at the varsity level, that kind of thing, it's not out of the realm of reality to say, right, they have one win. I think what's really surprising is Bishop Fenwick is 1-10-1. These guys can't catch a break, Willie. Yeah, they're up at Division I for the first time. You figure they take their lumps, but if you had told me they're 5-7 or they're 4-8, okay, yeah, tough, you know, sled and that kind of thing. But 1-10-1, I mean, I dug up a stat the other day. They played Lowell Catholic twice. A team they should beat. That's a team from the lower division in the Catholic Central League. They should beat.
Well, yeah,
they outshot them 82-27 in two games, right, and then a tie and a loss. I mean, what's going on over there?
I think it's just at this point.
Is it just one of those years?
Yeah,
I mean, it happens.
At this point, yeah. I mean, very difficult to recover from the start that they've had. I think, unfortunately, you know, at this point, like you said, you look at a team, Lowell Catholic, right? Without the stats in front of me, I'm going to guess that they beat Lowell Catholic six times in a row during that big streak in the CCL2, which caused them to move up to the CCL1. They outshoot them, like you said, 82-something in two games. 82 shots on net, and they're not going in the net. That tells me the boys
82
are,
shots on net, and they have two goals
right
in those two games.
That tells me the boys are gripping the sticks too tight, and that's just what happens when you're a kid. You're used to winning, and all of a sudden, you know, things are just getting away from you. You know, a lot of these guys haven't been in this situation before.
Right.
That just tells me they're gripping the sticks too tight. It is. It's just one of those types of years where, you know, things go against you. I call it the Cincinnati Bengals syndrome, you know. It happened to the Bengals every single game in the 90s.
Pre-Corey
and sports
Dillon?
Fans, yeah, even with Corey Dillon.
Okay.
Sports fans out there know what I'm talking about. You know, when you're in that kind of culture, you're just looking around waiting for something to go wrong. You know, and I think, unfortunately, that's kind of where Fenwick is at this point.
Yeah.
It's just one of those years where, you know, the puck is rubber, and it's going to bounce. And this year, it's bouncing against them. And you know, you hate to take control out of it and chalk it up to luck, certainly if you're a competitor. But I think Fenwick just isn't getting the luck this year. I mean, that's at some point, you just have to hang your head or just look up at the sky and say, this isn't our year.
Well, certainly we hope that Salem and Fenwick can procure a few more wins before season's out to give them a shot of team-wide adrenaline. You know?
Sure.
Hey, before we go, tip of the cap to Kevin Brown and the Danvers Falcons. They first team qualify in the area at 10-2. We think St. John's Prep will be next, and then hopefully we get quite a few more. Last year, we have all but one or two of our teams get in, which
yep.
was a great year. Probably not as many this year, but it'll be great to see down the stretch those teams we mentioned at the top of the broadcast, the Marbleheads, the PBDs, the Swampskits, Masconomets, and even Beverly, see what they can do to fight to get themselves into the tournament. So stick with us at the Salem News for all of your high school hockey coverage on the North Shore. It's the best anywhere you'll find. Matt Williams, myself, the rest of the staff here are at games. We tweet games, stats in the paper, whatever you want, we got it here. So for Matt Williams, I'm Phil Stacey. Thanks for watching the Salem News High School Hockey Podcast. We'll be back next week with some more puck knowledge for you.